The best thing about flying first class? Getting drunk super fast on free booze! Actually, that doesn't happen. But other things do happen to your body at altitude. Hey guys, an Earthbound Amy with you on D News today. That you get drunk faster at high altitudes is the myth people love because, well, a lot of humans like alcohol's effects. The problem is, that doesn't really happen. Multiple studies have shown that regardless of where you drink, your blood alcohol level will be the same. If you feel loopy and weird after one drink on a plane, it's more likely that your body is reacting to the altitude itself. But before we leave the Earth, let's start where many of us live, at sea level, or thereabouts. This is where humans have evolved to live comfortably. With one bar of atmospheric pressure, the air is thick and carries plenty of oxygen molecules to oxygenate our blood to keep our organs healthy. And because the pressure is greater outside our bodies than inside, it's easier for our lungs to fill, which helps keep our heart rates and blood pressures at a good level. But as you rise off the planet, say climbing a mountain, the air pressure steadily drops off. It's gravity that keeps the atmosphere on the surface. As the atmosphere thins, there's less oxygen available for your body, and things start to go bad pretty fast. Most of us will experience altitude at one point in our lives flying in an airplane. Though a commercial jet flies at about 30,000 feet, the cabin is pressurized, just not to sea level. It mimics about 8,000 feet, so it's harder on your body, but not so hard you would really notice. At 8,000 feet, the air pressure is lower, so there's less oxygen available. You might feel some symptoms of hypoxia, which is the condition where there is too little oxygen reaching your brain. Your respiration rate might increase too, as your body tries to get more oxygen out of the thin air, which in turn increases your heart rate as blood pumps furiously through your body, focusing on vital organs. This could make you feel sick. An increase in blood to the brain can cause headaches, while less blood to the digestive tract can leave you feeling nauseous and kill your appetite. But what if that cabin wasn't pressurized and you were exposed to the environment at that jet's cruising altitude of about 30,000 feet? Well, that's only a little higher than Everest's peak, which is at 29,029 feet, so we know what happens, and it's really not good. At 8,000 feet, humans become susceptible to altitude sickness. At 18,000 feet, there's half as much oxygen in the air as there is at sea level. The area above 25,000 feet is colorfully referred to as the death zone. And at Everest's peak, the air is so thin, it has only one-third the oxygen concentration of air at sea level. As the body tries to get more oxygen, your respiration rate increases, as does your heart rate to keep your organs from starving. And even breathing is harder. At 29,000 feet, the air pressure is so low, it's actually lower than the pressure in your lungs, so you have to work for each breath. The stress on your body can lead to incredible headaches, confusion, and complications. One is HAPE, which is swelling caused by excess fluid trapped in the lungs. It starts with a cough, weakness, and shortness of breath, and can be fatal within 24 hours, but can be cured if you get more oxygen. Rarer but scarier is HACE, the same condition affecting your brain that can seriously impair your functionality and demands medical attention. So how do people ski in Colorado or climb Everest? Acclimatization. It usually takes a few days to acclimatize to a higher altitude, but your body will become more efficient at taking deep breaths, producing more red blood cells to carry hemoglobin, and the pressure in your pulmonary arteries increases so your lungs become more efficient. And if you're doing all that, getting drunk faster should be the furthest thing from your mind. And speaking of flying, do you guys like to pass the time on long flights binge-watching your favorite shows? Now you can watch all kinds of great content with the new Discovery Go app, including one of my all-time favorites, When We Left Earth. You can check it out at the link below or download it from your app store. So we know why we might feel a little bit lightheaded on airplanes, but how can we actually breathe inside a sky tube? Trace has the answer to that question in this episode of D News right here.
Today, all commercial airlines have pressurized cabins to keep people breathing comfortably, but since they don't have tanks of air on board, they have to supplement the air in the cabin from some other source.
Would you guys ever climb Everest? Let us know in the comments below. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe right here for a new episode of D News every single day of the week.